to laugh and to cry together, and to value the impact that his leaving will have on each of us. The journey of grief is long, and those who walk it should not have to walk alone. In times like these, nothing takes the place of the love and support of family and friends. Your presence here today helps the family to realize how much Roger meant to all who knew him, and what an impact he had on so many people. On behalf of Karen and the entire family, I would like to thank you on their behalf for being with us today. Your kindness and friendship in these past days and weeks is most appreciated and will be forever remembered. Let us begin our service today in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, in these moments of remembrance and reflection, we lift our hearts to you, asking for your help in this time of sorrow. You know the sorrow that we feel as we say goodbye to Roger. Help us this day and give us courage, hope, and healing. Amen. I now ask Ron and the singers to lead in the singing of In the Garden.
And the joy.
Thank you. I would like to share a piece of scripture and a poem with you today. If you noticed on the back of your memorial folder, there's a picture on the back of it of the 23rd Psalm. This picture was taken from a laminated obituary given to Roger at the time of his father's funeral. Roger's dad's funeral was held on December the 8th, 1976, and Roger passed away on December the 8th, 2014. And we know today that father and son have now been reunited in heaven after 38 years apart. Please say the words along with me if you'd like. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Roger worked several jobs over the course of his working career. He worked as a security guard, a proctor, but the job he enjoyed and spent the most of his life doing was that of the farmer. In honor of his years working the land, I would like to read the poem, Close the Gate. For this one farmer, the worries are over. Lie down and rest your head. Your time has been and struggles enough. Put the tractor in the shed. Years were not easy, many downright hard, but your faith in God transcended. Put away your tools and sleep in peace. The fences have all been mended. You raised a fine family, worked the land well, and always followed the sun. Hang up your shovel inside the barn. Your work here on earth is done. A faith few possess led your journey through life, often a jagged and stony way. The sun is setting, the cattle are all bedded, and here now is the end of your day. Your love of God's soil has passed on to your kin. The stories flow like fine wine. Wash off your work boots in the puddle left by blessed rain one final time. You always believed that the good Lord would provide, and he always had somehow. Take off your gloves and put them down. No more sweat and worry for you now. Your labor is done. Your home now is heaven. No more must you wait. Your legacy lives on, your love of the land, and we will close the gate. I would ask Marcel Corbell to come forward at this time and sing the hymn, Peace in the Valley.
I only met Roger in October. A unique way that we met, I got a little card called Have Bible Travel, and he saw my card at Chicken Chef and he phoned me. And together we formed a bond in a couple weeks that most people takes a lifetime. He wanted to know more than man's tradition. He wanted to know what does the Bible have to say. Together and with others, we became good friends, formed a bond that I'll never forget. Yeah. So it's my pleasure today, Karen and family, to sing the song, Peace in the Valley.
Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along. Peace in the valley for me. I pray. There's no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I see. There'll be peace in the valley for me. Here the flowers will be blooming, and the grass will be green, and the sky will be clear and serene.
Roger and Karen's close friends Judith and Morris Maggie will now come forward and share a tribute to Roger's life.
Roger Schappert was born on August the 2nd, 1942, on their family farm, 4 miles north of Marshall Wells, Saskatchewan. His parents were Conrad and Eleanor Lowenberg Schappert. He was their youngest and only son, with 4 older sisters, Irene, Nora, Rosemary, and Juanita. From 1966 to 1985, he was married to Marietta Mack, and they had a family of 3 children, Kimberly, Corrine, and Dale. Roger and Marietta have 8 grandchildren, Satasha, Angela, Kelsey, Blake, Mackenzie, Bryce, Gibson, and Chuby. They also have 2 great-grandchildren, Yinka and Kenny. In 1997, Roger married Karen Bateman Bernardin, and it is at that time he became a stepfather to Martin, Michael, and Janice Bernardin, and now a grandpa to 6 more grandchildren. Roger worked at various jobs, but his first and foremost love was farming. He received certification as a corrections officer, and he also worked as a security guard. He also completed a course to become a health care aide. During his work in the health field, he enjoyed working at the St. Christopher's Home in Laurier, and in the past few years in St. Rose. Roger passed away at the St. Rose Hospital with his son Dale at his side on Monday, December 8, 2014, from cancer of the esophagus.
that most of you here today never knew that Morris and I were related to Roger. You know the expression shirt-tailed relatives? Well, we were cat-tailed relatives. Our daughter had a kitten to give away, so we brought him to Roger, and each time we visited at their farm, Roger would cuddle his cat like a baby in his big arms, and he would say, "Here are your grandparents, Min Min, and they have come to visit." He loved and cared for his precious Min in such a special way for over 16 years. Over the years, we have often said that if we were cattle, we would like to live at Karen and Roger's farm. Roger was so gentle with his cattle, and they lived ever so comfortably under that care. Roger talked to us a lot about his parents and his life in Saskatchewan. Even after all his years living in Manitoba, he remained a die-hard fan of the Saskatchewan Rough Riders, and he was pleased as can be whenever he received gifts of sports memorabilia of his team. Their farm in Saskatchewan had beautiful spruce trees, and Roger was certainly proud and pleased when he planted a little spruce tree in their front yard of the Laurier farm, and it thrived. It is now a gorgeous 20-foot-tall tree. It was wonderful to hear how grateful he was to have had the upbringing that he had. He spoke fondly of the work he and his dad did together. He grew up keeping their farm neat and tidy, and when he came here to Laurier, he set to work like a whirlwind to have their farm look the same. He enjoyed the positive feedback when he heard their neighbors say, "Roger cleaned the face of the earth." Roger took pride in whatever job he took on. He did a superb job helping Karen at our library. It was kept spotless, just like their farm. Roger enjoyed the physical exertion involved in farming. He would say he had no need for a modern hoof pounder, as a good old sledgehammer could do the job. Late this fall, even with his health failing, he managed to pound posts straight as an arrow in preparation for the snow fence. He enjoyed projects around the farm, with the last one being a new patio that turned out just as he had planned. Roger cared about people, especially those that he was proctor for. His clients were appreciated for their courage to remain strong during difficult times in their lives. His quiet, unassuming ways helped to foster that courage. Roger loved vintage cars. They were his passion, as can be seen by the unique urn built especially for him. We will hold fast to memories of going with Roger and Karen for milkshakes with the top down in his white convertible to his favorite coffee shop at Chicken Chef. It will feel strange now to drive into town and not see one of Roger's vehicles parked there. He very much enjoyed going there and spoke so nicely of their staff and how well he was treated. Last year, Karen sent me an email that simply said, "Friendship is a thread that sews all hearts together." It is so true. Roger has been a part of our lives for the past 20 years, and we loved and respected him very much. We feel one of the most striking attributes Roger had was that he never talked badly to us about anyone. He was a good, honest man and a very dear friend. Karen and I know that a part of Roger and Morris's friendship came as both men have needed to watch the news daily and both men checked the weather faithfully before setting out anywhere. Roger would have been pleased to know that it was favorable travel weather this week. Not a day went by that Roger did not read his Bible. He tried his best to abide by the principles laid out in the Bible, and at times that was difficult, but he tried. And in the trying, he strived to become a better person. Roger was a man who had a strong belief in prayer. Roger showed his love and Roger showed his loving commitment to Karen in many ways. She had with him her own personal hairdresser after he took over the responsibility of dyeing her hair each month. Who would have thought? Monsieur Roger. He loved to surprise her with fresh flowers, and he always understood and supported her need to be with her children and grandchildren as often as was possible. It was during the times that Karen was away that Roger spent more time at our home. Our last visit alone with Roger was very touching. He sat at our kitchen table and calmly told us about his acceptance that his life was soon ending. He clearly stated how grateful he was to have been a father, a grandfather, and a great-grandfather. He had lived 72 years and had loved and had been loved, and that he was ready to meet his Maker. What a perfect way to accept what he knew was in the near future. I have recently read these lines that I would like to share for all who experienced the gracious love that was within Roger's heart. Deep within each heart, through all life's changing seasons, love remembers love.
Thank you, Judith and Morris. If we could have the lights turned off at the back, and I'd just ask everyone to direct your attention to the stage, and we'll watch a video tribute celebrating Roger's life.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and His glory, of Jesus and His love. I love to tell the story because I know it satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of glory I sing the new song, 'twill be the old story that I have loved so long. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory to tell the old story of Jesus and his love, to tell surveyed all the good things that come to me from above, if I count all the blessings from the storehouse of love, I'd simply ask for a favor of him beyond mortal ken, and I'm sure that he'd grant it again. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven with you. Places of beauty we long to see here below, but time and treasures have kept us from making plans, as you know. But come the morning of the rapture, together we'll stand anew while I stroll over heaven with you. I want to stroll over heaven with you some glad day, when all our troubles and heartaches are vanished away. Then we'll enjoy the beauty where all things are new. I want to stroll over heaven. I want to stroll over heaven with you.
Ask the choir to come forward at this time. Hear this in the singing of Here I Am.
Mm-hmm. Hi, everybody. I'm Roger's son. You can call me Dale, but my dad had a special name for me when I was a little boy. He called me Schnitz. Sometimes he called me Schnitzy. I don't know where he came up with that name, but it's something that I'll always remember about my dad when I was a little boy. He just had that name called Schnitz. So, I remember growing up as a little boy on our farm 4 miles north of Marchville, the same farm that Dad was born on in 1942. I remember Dad telling me all kinds of little stories about how when he was growing up, and he actually made up this one story about these kids named Edward and Samantha, and he'd tell me that story every night before bed. I don't know where he came with that girl and boy, but I always loved him telling me stories about Edward and Samantha. I also remember at that time in our life that Jesus and the Bible was very important in our family. In fact, it was so important to us and such a focus in our family that I remember me and my sisters would actually act out stories from the Bible. We didn't have superheroes or any TV shows. We were just playing stories from the Bible. Now, I also remember a few years ago my dad telling me how he always thought it was so odd and funny at funerals, how everybody would always say how the person who was deceased was such a great person and no one ever mentioned anything about the trials and tribulations they went through in their lives. Everything was sugar-coated and they were just the perfect person. And yes, my dad was a great man. For sure he was. Dad also told me a couple of weeks ago when he knew his time was coming and that the end was near, make sure everybody knows that I was also miserable and I complained a lot. After all, he had a lot to complain about. He was a Saskatchewan Rough Riders fan, after all. And if you can believe it, he even had a few pairs of green and white Saskatchewan Rough Rider socks, which I think my sister bought for him. And just so you know, Dad, just like your grandson Shabe is wearing the Saskatchewan Rough Rider shirt in the front row, I sent my son Bryce to school today with his Saskatchewan Rough Rider shirt on just for you. Sorry. I always remember when I phoned Dad and I told him that I had Bryce, because the Schappert name was living on with me, and I remember I phoned Dad and he was so proud and happy that the Schappert name was living on. And then when I told him that we named him Bryce, but I gave him the second name, Conrad, which was his dad's name, he was very proud. He was very proud of that. So we also had another son, so the Schappert name is definitely going to live on. I also think that my dad was secretly a Toronto Maple Leafs fan, even though he would never admit it. But when it came to talking about hockey, all Dad would tell me about was how the Leafs had never won the Cup since 1967. So there you go. There's two good reasons why he was miserable, being a Rough Riders fan and a Maple Leafs fan. But my dad had a lot of good times. A few weeks ago, he told me his favorite place and the best time of his life was when he was living on the farm with Karen. I also know that my dad was very happy when he was a young boy helping his dad on the farm back in Saskatchewan. But there was a time in my dad's life when things went very bad and he was not happy at all. It was the day that Jesus and the Bible wasn't important in our family anymore. We moved away from the farm and made our way to Brandon. And then the demons got a hold of my dad. They took my dad down hard and brought him down to the lowest point ever in his life. The demons knew they had to take my dad down so they could break our family apart. And Dad, if you're listening right now, and I know you are, I just want you to know that nothing was ever your fault, and we all make mistakes. I do honestly forgive you for anything you ever did wrong, and I love you. We all make mistakes. For a short while, my dad and my two sisters lived with my dad in a tiny little one-bedroom apartment in downtown Brandon. There were some really good times in that little place, but there were also some really bad and dark times. I'm not going to talk about any of the bad stuff, but one of the memories I have of being in that place was when my dad was working a security job, and he had this set of handcuffs, and I decided that I was going to put them on my sister Kim. Well, I can't remember exactly what happened, but I think the key broke or something, and we couldn't get the handcuffs off. My sister was stuck with these handcuffs on her hands, so we had to phone my dad to come and rescue us to get them off. Let me tell you, he was not impressed with us at all. All four of us didn't live together in that apartment for very long. My sisters moved out to start their lives of their own, and it was just me and my dad. I think I was about 13 years old at the time, and things had gotten really bad, and my dad was down really low in his life. Lower than he had ever been before. His addictions had really taken over, and I decided I had to leave, and I turned my back on my dad and left in the middle of the night to go live with my mom in Winnipeg. I know this hurt my dad very much that I left him. And Dad, if you're listening right now, I am sorry, and I know that you have forgiven me. I remember just this past spring when I went to visit my dad for an afternoon at the farm, I sat down on the deck with him and I said to Dad that I told him I was very sorry about anything I ever did to hurt him. And he looked at me and he gave me a hug and he said, Dale, it's okay. About 7 years later, I had reached my lowest point in my life. Everything was going against me. Nothing in my life was working. I think I was about 21 at this point and I was living in Yorkton. My so-called friends had actually turned against me and were my enemies. My own addictions were taking over, and I had nowhere else to turn. So I picked up the phone and I called my dad. I said, "Dad, I need some help. Can you please come and get me?" Without having a second thought, my dad got in his car and arrived 3 hours later. We packed up my few little things that I owned and headed back to Brandon. I moved in with him into a different one-bedroom apartment that he already occupied. While I was there, I slept on the couch, and we were like roommates. And we started to mend our relationship. One of my best memories of living in that apartment was watching the Toronto Blue Jays win the World Series not once, but twice. We watched pretty much every game together. Most guys my age, I think I was around 22 or so, would have been out having beers with their friends and watching the World Series. But me, I just hung out with my dad, and we watched it together. It was a good time, and it was fun, just me and my dad. But during those years we lived together in that apartment, my dad was still very sad. He soon met Karen. Apparently, I was the one who encouraged my dad to go out that night and go have some fun at a singles dance. I don't remember saying that, but this is what I've been told, that I was the one that said it. So, when Dad met Karen, he started being happy again. I remember him going out to the farm for the weekend. I knew that Dad was having a great time on the farm with Karen. He couldn't stop talking about Karen. In fact, Karen showed me a picture the other day of Dad walking around on the farm in his underwear. So he must have been having some kind of fun out on the farm. Oh, and I forgot to mention in that picture, he was walking around in his underwear and carrying a slop pail. Only on the farm can you walk around in your underwear and carry a slop pail. No wonder he was so happy. Anyway, soon after Dad and Karen met, they ended up getting married. My dad was once again very happy. He was back on the farm, and it was through Karen that I truly believe that my dad came back to the Lord. You see, my dad fell away from the Lord and reading the Bible. When he wasn't following the Lord, he was at the lowest point ever. Exactly the same way I was when I turned away from my dad, I had reached my lowest point. But the beautiful thing about this is, just like how I reached out to my dad and he came to rescue me, we can all do this and reach out to the Lord, and he will come and rescue us if we are at our lowest point. No matter how awful we are or how terrible of a person we have become, the Lord will always be there to rescue us from our deepest and darkest hours and cleanse us of all our sins and hurts. I know my dad made peace with the Lord, and I know he was with him right now. In fact, a few weeks ago, when Dad was in the hospital in St. Rose, he woke up from a deep sleep. Sorry, it wasn't a few weeks ago, it was a week ago. He woke up from a deep sleep, and he said a few times, "When is the wedding? When is the wedding?" Me and Karen and Corrine were there, and we all were wondering, what wedding is he talking about? I asked him the next day, "Dad, what wedding are you talking about?" He looked at me and he said, "I was singing at a wedding." I knew then that Dad was talking about the great wedding of Christ and his believers. This wedding is referenced many times in the Bible. My dad was diagnosed with esophageal cancer 47 days ago. And here we are today at his funeral. I was with him in that room that night. I held him close to me and I told him I loved him. I gave him his last glass of water. I listened to him breathe, and I heard his last breath of air. Life is a precious gift. Make the most of each day. Love your kids. Love your spouse. Do something for someone in need. Forgive someone who has wronged you. And be thankful to God for everything you have. Here's one last memory from when I was a kid. My dad used to have an old movie camera. It was for silent movies and there was no sound. I remember him and my mom used to take movies of me and my sisters when we were kids. My dad also had lots of old reel-to-reels of when he was growing up, because that movie camera came from his parents. So there was lots of clips of my dad growing up on the farm. I just remember it was such a huge excitement in our house to put up the movie screen, pull out the projector, turn the lights off, and cuddle under the blankets and have a family movie night. We watched all those old silent movies over and over again. It was just so much fun. A few days ago, I pulled out those old movies and watched my dad when he was a happy teenager on the farm. When he was a happy young father. And most importantly, when he was following the Lord. Well, I guess this is it. Here it is, just one more home movie night. This is for you, Dad. I love you so much.
Sins and griefs to bear, and what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Can we find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share? Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer.
Thank you, Dale. Today's service will conclude here at the hall, with interment to be held at a later date on the farm. The family will exit the hall during the recessional song, and I would ask those of you remaining here in the hall to assist with setting up the tables for the lunch. And once everything is set, I will bring the family back in, and we'll say grace and enjoy lunch and time of fellowship and sharing of memories. I'll now read the benediction. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Roger Schappert. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your fold, a lamb of your flock, a sinner of your redeeming. Receive him into your arms, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace and happiness. Amen. To those I love and those who love me, when I am gone, release me. Let me go. I have so many things to see and do. You mustn't tie yourself to me with too many tears, but be thankful we had so many good years. I gave you my love, and you can only guess how much you've given to me in happiness. I thank you all for the love you have shown, but now it is time I traveled on alone. So grieve for me a while if grieve you must, then let your grief be comforted by trust. It is only for a while that we must part, so treasure the memories within your heart. I won't be far away, for life goes on. And if you need me, call, and I'll come. Though you can't see or touch me, I will be near. And if you listen with your heart, you'll hear all of my love around you, soft and clear. And then, when you come this way alone, I'll greet you with a smile and a welcome home. May you go forward today with a small flickering of light in your soul. May the memories you have of Roger bring comfort. May the words, touch, and presence of others bring solace. And may you be blessed in your coming in and your going out, grateful for a life lived and a wonderful legacy left behind. Let us go in peace. Our recessional hymn is How Great Thou Art.
We go out first, is that right?